Okay, last day finally we discuss the plant tissues. Now we are moving to the new section, plant growth. Okay, you know what growth is from your young ages. You know that what growth is. So what is growth? We can simply say growth is an irreversible increase of dry mass of an organism which is associated with its development. So what is growth again? It's irreversible increase of dry mass of organisms which is associated with its development. Okay. When we are discussing plant tissues, we said meristems of plants involve in primary growth. So we said what happens in meristems? Meristems contain continuously dividing cells known as initials. We said that those initials continuously divide by mitosis and add new cells to the plant. Then those new cells added are elongated and then differentiate and involve in producing permanent tissues. That's how growth process happens. Simply, meristems of plants involve in growth. Okay, but if you consider growth patterns of organisms, so generally it's like this. So here we can graphically express the growth pattern of an organism. Imagine x-axis is the time or the lifespan of the organism, and for the y-axis you can consider growth, or it is the increase, it is the dry mass. You consider dry mass or growth. So it's like this. At the beginning of the lifespan, organisms show slow growth rate. So it's like this. That means dry mass of organism gradually increases, but comparatively at a slow rate. But with time, in the lifespan, growth rate gradually increases like this. Here you can observe growth rate gradually increases. Then at a particular period, growth rate becomes very rapid. That means growth happens at a very rapid rate. That means dry mass of organism irreversibly increase at a very rapid rate at a particular period of the lifespan. Then after a certain period, again here it's like this. You can observe growth rate gradually decreases again, like this. So here again, at the beginning of lifespan, there's slow growth rate. You can observe, if you consider the slope of this graph, you can observe it clearly. At the beginning, then the growth rate is very low. Increase of dry mass happens at a slow rate. But after a particular period, within a particular period of lifespan, there's a rapid growth. We can observe in organisms, not only in plants, in animals as well. Then after a certain period, again, growth rate slows down. Here you can observe the slope is high here. That means growth rate is high. Then towards the end of the lifespan, again, growth rate is comparatively low. So it's like this. Okay, then here you can copy this graph on your note. There's a space under the growth patterns of organisms. Under that, copy this graph first. Okay, copy this graph. X-axis is time or the lifespan of organism. Y-axis is growth or the dry mass. Okay, I think it's done. So then here, then the if you consider the growth rate, we said that the slope of this graph indicates the growth rate. So here, if you consider the growth rate, it's like this. Now we are plotting the growth rate versus time of the lifespan. Growth rate. Yeah, as we said earlier, at the beginning of the lifespan, growth rate is comparatively low. So it's like this. Here, growth rate is comparatively low at the beginning of lifespan. Then you can observe, as we said earlier, growth rate gradually increases. Here, growth rate gradually increases. Then, at a particular period of the lifespan, growth rate becomes maximum. We said. Then here, there is a rapid growth rate at this period. Like this. Then, after that, as we said earlier, growth rate decreases like this. Okay, so this is the, here we can represent the growth rate versus time of the lifespan like this. Okay, you can copy this as well. Copy this to the note. There's a space here. Okay. Here, this is a general pattern of growth in organisms. But if you consider plant growth and animal growth, there are differences. There are basic differences in plant growth and animal growth. We can say plants, mainly perennial plants. What are perennial plants? Plants with the lifespan of many years are known as perennial plants or perennials. Perennial plants show indeterminate growth. Perennial plants show indeterminate growth. Here, they show indeterminate growth. Perennial plants show indeterminate growth. What's the indeterminate growth? That means they grow continuously throughout the lifespan. Then there is no particular period. Throughout the lifespan, they continuously grow. Such a growth is known as indeterminate growth. But if you consider some parts of perennials as flowers, fruits, leaves, they do not show indeterminate growth. Then they show determinate growth. They show determinate growth. Determinate. So what is determinate? We said indeterminate means they grow continuously throughout the lifespan. But then determinate means they grow within a particular period of the lifespan. Growth occurs within a particular period of lifespan. Then it is known as determinate. So then within a particular period they grow up to a certain size. Then their growth stops. Then it is known as determinate. Then even in perennial plants, flowers, leaves, fruits, they show determinate growth. They grow up to a certain size and then their growth stops. Such one is known as determinate growth. That's about perennials. Again, here perennial plants show indeterminate growth, but parts of the perennial plants like flowers, fruits and leaves show determinate growth. But if you consider annual plants, so what are annuals? The plants with the lifespan of 1 year are known as annuals. Those annual plants and also biennial plants. Biennial plants means plants with the lifespan of 2 years. Those annual plants and biennial plants show determinate growth. Got that? Perennials show indeterminate growth. Annuals and biennials show determinate growth. That means annuals and biennials grow up to a certain size within a particular period of lifespan. Then their growth stops. Then they reproduce and then die. That is determinate growth. Okay. Animals also show this determinate growth. Then think about yourself. Your growth happens within a particular period. Then their growth stops. It is applicable to other animals as well. So then the first difference between plant growth and animal growth is plants show mainly perennials. Perennial plants show indeterminate growth. Animals show determinate growth. Remember that. That's the first difference. Secondly, we said growth of a plant occurs due to the activity of meristems. Then that means all parts of the plants do not grow. In a plant, growth is confined to meristems. Only meristems grow. Permanent tissues do not involve in growth. Only meristems grow. But if you consider animals, in animals, growth is not confined to a particular part of the body. So during the growth of animals, all parts of the body proportionately grow. Got that? So then that's the second difference. Again, what's the second difference? In plants, growth is confined to meristems. Growth occurs only in meristems. But in animals, growth is not confined to a particular part or particular organ of the body. Then all body parts of an animal proportionately grow during the growth of the animal. So then that's the second difference. So note that and underline that in your note. Then we can move to primary growth structure of dicotyledonous plants root. First we'll discuss the primary growth structure of dicotyledonous plant root. What is primary growth in respect to root? Primary growth of root means elongation of root due to the addition of new cells by the activity of apical meristems. Again, primary growth of root means elongation of the root due to the addition of new cells by the activity of apical meristems found at the apex of the root. So here we discuss that under tissues as well. So it's like this. Here if you simply consider root apex, if you consider root apex, it's like this. We said at the imagine this is a longitudinal section. Imagine this is a LS or longitudinal section of a root apex. We said towards the apex there are three overlapping regions. There are three overlapping regions, as here this is zone of cell division found at the apex. Upper to that it has zone of cell elongation. So this is zone of elongation. Then upper to that it has zone of maturation. So let's say this is zone of maturation. Upper to that, here it has permanent tissues. Here these are the permanent tissues. Then if you consider zone of cell division, zone of division, here at the apex, or here at the apex it has a root cap. Here it is root cap. This root cap surrounds the apical meristem. So at this position it has apical meristem. Apical meristem is found at the apex of root.
You know that these apical meristems contain initials. They divide. Those initials divide by mitosis and add new cells. So new cells added are pushed downwards and also inwards. New cells added are pushed outwards and also inwards. These new cells added towards the inner side are pushed towards the zone of elongation. Then they are elongated. Those elongated cells are then added to zone of maturation. Then within the zone of maturation, those elongated cells are matured. That means they undergo differentiation and produce permanent tissues. So here, then the permanent tissues can be observed upper to the zone of maturation. Within the zone of maturation, cells are differentiated and produce different permanent tissues. Xylem tissue, phloem tissue, parenchyma cells, collenchyma cells, likewise, not collenchyma. Collenchyma not found in roots, sclerenchyma, all are produced by this cell differentiation. Okay, then here, we can discuss about this differentiation process happening in the root apex. Before that, we can discuss it in detail. Before that, we will consider the growth structure found in this permanent tissue region. We'll consider growth structure found in this permanent tissue region. Here we will consider a transverse section. We first consider transverse section to discuss the growth structure found at this permanent tissue region. Then you can clearly understand how differentiation process happens in the zone of maturation to produce these permanent tissues. Therefore, first we will discuss primary growth structure of dicotyledonate plant root at the permanent tissue region. Then we can consider a longitudinal section like this again, and then we can discuss how this cell differentiation occurs. Okay. Then we will move to primary growth structure of dicotyledonate plant root under permanent tissues. So go to the diagram or refer the diagram given under this topic, primary growth structure of dicotyledonate plant root under permanent tissues. Primary growth structure of, I'll write shortly, dicot plant root under permanent tissues. Okay, then here in your note, there's a histological diagram. It is given at your left hand side, and also part of a light micrography is given at your right hand side. Here we will consider a diagram to discuss the permanent tissue section. Imagine this is a transverse section. Okay, here it's like this. Outermost cellular layer, you know what outermost cellular layer of a leaf, root and stem, what is that? Generally it is epidermis. So here in root also, outermost cellular structure is the epidermis. Imagine now I am drawing a transverse section of dicot root. Okay, then here outermost tissue layer is the epidermis. Imagine this is epidermis. Okay, here I have drawn a part of histological structure of this transverse section. Imagine this a diagram like this. Here, if you consider a small section like this and get the histological structure, it will be appeared like this. Okay, so therefore, here we can identify this, the same tissue layers in this histological diagram as well. So here, so this is epidermis. This is outermost tissue layer. You can observe here, you know that epidermal cells are closely packed to each other. There are no intercellular spaces. And these epidermal cells are living cells, but lack chloroplast. Okay, then here you can observe some of these epidermal cells have unicellular cytoplasmic projections, which are projected into the soil solution or projected into soil. Those are known as root hairs. Here, so this is a root hair. So here, some of the epidermal cells, as you can observe here, have root hairs. So therefore, we can indicate like this. Here, some of the epidermal cells have root hairs. Okay, so these are the root hairs. Here I will label. So these are root hair. The epidermis. Okay, that's epidermis. So what's the function? Here you have to know the structure as well as the function of these
tissue layers or each cell type or each tissue type. So what's the function of epidermis? So what's the general function? You know that. Epidermis generally involving providing defense to internal part of the root because it has tightly packed cells. In addition to that, in roots, this epidermis involves in absorption of water and mineral ions from outer soil solution. So what's the role of these root hairs in absorption of water? These root hairs increase the surface area. Root hairs increase the surface area of absorption of water and mineral ions from soil solution. Remember that. Okay, then that means it facilitates absorption of water from soil solution by increasing the surface area. And note here, root hairs are unicellular cytoplasmic processes. They are not multicellular structures. They are unicellular cytoplasmic processes. Okay, here that about the epidermis. Inner to epidermis, here you can observe it has another tissue layer. It is known as cortex. This is cortex. Here, inner tissue layer, second tissue, inner to epidermis, second tissue layer is the cortex. So I will indicate the cortex like this. Imagine this is the cortex. I will indicate the cortex like this. It is comparatively a thick tissue layer than the epidermis. So it has several cell layers. Here this is the cortex. It's mainly made up of parenchyma cells. You can observe here. These are parenchyma cells with vacuolated cytoplasm. And also there are intercellular spaces. Here you can observe there are intercellular spaces. So these parenchyma cells involve in storage. But here in root, it involves in transporting of water absorbed by the epidermis towards the inner xylem. It is known as radial transport. Therefore, simply we can say cortex involved in radial transport of water absorbed by epidermis towards the inner xylem. That's the main function. In addition to that, these parenchyma cells generally involve in storage. Okay, that's about the cortex. Inner to cortex here, there's a single cell layer. Inner to cortex, you can observe there's a single cell layer. It is known as endodermis. Inner to cortex. Here, there is a cell layer known as endodermis. Endodermis. So, this is the endodermis. You can observe it. Endodermis. It's a single cell layer. Here, look at these endodermal cells. These endodermal cells are also tightly packed cells without intercellular spaces. They are living cells. They have only primary cell walls. Only primary cell walls, remember, they have only primary cell walls. They are closely packed together without intercellular spaces. No intercellular spaces. But there is a specialty. There is a specialty of these endodermal cells. Single cell layer. But there is a specialty in these endodermal cells. We said they have only primary cell wall. But here they have suberine deposits. Suberine is deposit as a belt. Here suberine is deposit as a belt in the primary cell wall of these endodermal cells. These belts of suberin are known as Casparian strips. Here, Casparian strip. These Casparian strips are found in radial and transverse walls. Remember, these Casparian strips or suberin belts are found in radial and transverse walls of these endodermal cells. So, what are these radial and transverse walls? So, it's like this. If you consider, we can discuss this endodermis when you are discussing plant transport as well again. If you consider endodermal cell, it's like this simply. Yeah, I will draw it in a 3D view. Imagine it's like this. So here, imagine this is an endodermal cell. The suberin belt or Casparian strip can be observed in radial and transverse walls. So it's like this. Imagine it's a radial wall. Here, it is found only in radial and transverse walls like this. Got that? Here, this is the Casparian strip. So this part is, this is the Casparian strip. So it involves in, it found in radial and transverse walls of the endodermal cells. If you consider transverse section or cross section, if you consider transverse section like this, then you can observe these Casparian strips like this. Here, if you consider transverse section of this endodermal cell like this, then you can observe Casparian strips like this. So what's the importance of these suberinized Casparian strips? We can say function of it is, it blocks the apoplastic route of water transportation in water. We can discuss about water transport in, or we can discuss about radial transport of water when you're discussing plant transport. There are actually three pathways or three routes of water transport in plants. Those are apoplastic route, symplastic root and transmembrane root. So apoplastic root simply occurs through interconnected cell walls and intercellular spaces. Here we said that the water and mineral ions are absorbed by the epidermis. That water and mineral ions absorbed are transported through these cortical cells during the radial transport. During that, apoplastic root is also operated. During the apoplastic root, water and mineral ions are transported through these interconnected cell walls and intercellular spaces up to the endodermis. Then at the endodermis, here due to the presence of these Casparian strips, apoplastic root is blocked. It has other functions as well. It involves in or it facilitates selective absorption of mineral ions into the plant, and also it acts as a barrier for toxic materials and unneeded substances. There are other functions as well. We can discuss those when we are discussing plant transport. Until then, remember the structure and the main function. Okay, then that's about the endodermis. Here, imagine this is an endodermal cell. Inner to the endodermis, there is another tissue layer. It is known as pericycle. Here, imagine. Now, I am drawing pericycle. So, this is pericycle. Here, in this histological structure, I can draw the pericycle like this. So, it may consist of specialized parenchyma cells. Here you can observe. It may consist of two or three cell layers. Those are living cells. Here, in these pericycle cells in dicot root, here we are discussing dicot root. In dicot root, these pericycle cells later in the lifespan get the meristematic activity or get the meristematic capacity. That means, in other words, we can say pericycle involving secondary growth. And during the secondary growth, they get the meristematic activity and involve in producing the second lateral meristem known as cocambium. Pericycle get the meristematic capacity during the secondary growth of dicot plant root and involve in producing the cocambium. That's its main function. Okay. In order the pericycle, it has vascular body. Here you can observe in order the pericycle, it has vascular body. Dicot root has single cylindrical vascular body. It has both primary xylem as well as primary phloem. So it's like this. Here, if you consider xylem of dicot root is like this. We can see it has a star shape, or it has four arms like this. Imagine this region is the primary xylem. It is indicated in blue color here. Here, in this histological structure, I have indicated xylem like this. Imagine this is xylem, primary xylem. Here, imagine this is a vessel element. Here, this is xylem. I will label it like this. This is primary xylem. You can observe it has four arms or four corners. Okay, then phloem is arranged like this. Here, primary phloem regions. They are arranged in between arms of this primary xylem within these grooves. Here it's like this. Within these grooves, in between arms of the primary xylem, it has phloem regions. Here, these are the primary phloem regions. Primary phloem regions are found in between arms of primary xylem within the grooves. Within these grooves. Here, there are four primary phloem regions. Imagine this is primary phloem. This is primary phloem. Okay. Here you can observe, in between primary xylem and primary phloem, there's another tissue layer. Here, it is made up of parenchyma. That parenchyma tissue layer found between primary xylem and primary phloem is known as conjunctive tissue. This conjunctive tissue. Okay. Here, remember, it's a single vascular cylinder or single vascular bundle. It has primary xylem, single region with four arms and four primary phloem regions. Okay, here you can observe here this primary xylem has four arms or four corners. Therefore, such a primary xylem is known as tetrarch xylem. Here, primary xylem is known as tetrarch. Tetrarch xylem. Since it consists of four arms or four corners, we can term it as tetrarch xylem. Tetrarch. Combining tetrarch xylem. Remember this word as well. Okay. Here, if you consider this primary xylem and primary phloem, based on the origin, this primary xylem can be divided into two parts. Phloem also like that. Got that? Primary xylem can be divided into two parts based on the origin. or based on the time of differentiation. Those are protoxylem and metaxylem. Again, primary xylem consists of two regions as protoxylem and metaxylem, based on the time of differentiation or origin. Phloem also like that. Primary phloem consists of two regions based on the origin. Those are protophloem and metaphloem. Here we will discuss how they are arranged here. Okay, then here, if you consider the primary xylem region, that we said it consists of two regions as protoxylem and metaxylem. Among these two xylem regions, protoxylem originate first or differentiate first. So then here in the dicot root, protoxylem that originate first is found towards the periphery. Here this is the periphery, this is the middle. Here protoxylem, this protoxylem, it is arranged towards the periphery of these arms of the primary xylem. Then this protoxylem region consists of comparatively narrow xylem vesicles. Imagine these are the xylem vesicles. Then the later originator, first protoxylem is originator, later the metaxylem is originator. Here metaxylem is found towards the center. So this is metaxylem. Metaxylem consists of comparatively broad xylem vessel elements. Imagine these are this is the metaxylem and these are xylem vessel elements. Got that? Here again, protoxylem is, remember this, when we are discussing the different protoxylem and metaxylem, mainly the direction where protoxylem and metaxylem should be, or metaxylem are found, should be memorized, because when we are discussing the differentiation process of these permanent tissues at the root apex, you will come across the locations of this protoxylem and metaxylem. Those are needed. Phloem also like that. We said earlier, primary phloem also consists of two regions based on the origin, protophloem and metaphloem. So here, among these, protophloem that originate first is found more towards the periphery. So let's say this is protophloem. Then metaphloem is located more medial to protophloem. So here metaphloem is located towards the middle side. So this is metaphloem. Got that? Protophloem is located towards the periphery, which originates first. Then metaphloem is originated later and it is located medial to protophloem. Got that? Okay, here then we said earlier also, conjunctive tissue is found between primary xylem and primary phloem. Okay, then there's one more thing. You know that here the xylem involves in ascent of xylem sap, phloem involves in phloem translocation. Okay, then additionally here, remember this as well. Here we said this primary xylem region, this primary xylem consists of four arms or four corners like this. Since it has four corners, we said it has a tetrarch xylem. One more, another thing. Based on the location or based on the orientation of this protoxylem, we can give another name for this xylem. Here, protoxylem. Among protoxylem and metaxylem, protoxylem is arranged towards the periphery and metaxylem is arranged towards the medial side to protoxylem. Since protoxylem is arranged towards the periphery, this type of xylem is also known as exarch xylem. Exarch is a tetrarch xylem and also exarch xylem. Exarch means, since protoxylem is arranged towards the periphery of the primary xylem, it is known as exarch. Then there is an opposite word to this as well. It is endarch. So then, what may be the meaning of endarch? Here, when protoxylem is arranged towards the periphery, it is known as exarch. Exarch. When protoxylem is arranged towards the middle, it is known as endarch. So endarch xylem is found in the shoot, not in the root. Okay, so this is the permanent tissue structure. Then we can discuss how this permanent tissue is differentiated at the root apex. Then we will consider longitudinal section or LS of a root apex. So it's like this. Here, I will erase this part. Before copy this, I erased those. So this should be the epidermis. This is cortex. Then this is endodermis. And this is pericycle. So copy this diagram onto your notes. So this is a transverse section. So you can write a title to this diagram. It's a diagram of transverse section of primary growth structure of dicotyledon plant root under permanent tissues. So copy this diagram within the given space and label all these parts. You should know to draw the diagram. So these can be asked in essays as well. Here simply, if the question asks, actually those are asked previously as well, again it can be asked. If a question asks to describe the primary growth structure of dicotyledon plant root, first we have to draw the fully labeled diagram like this. You can draw this diagram. So here when you are drawing the diagram, you can pause the video and take time to draw the diagram. Okay, then we will discuss how this permanent tissue structure is originated or differentiated at the root apex. Okay, so it's like this. Here, imagine this is the root apex. Here I will draw here. Imagine this is a longitudinal section or LS. LS of a root apex. We said earlier also, then there are three zones. Three overlapping zones are found at the root apex. Zone of division, zone of elongation and zone of maturation. So zone of division is found towards the apex. Imagine here, this is the zone of division. Let's say this part is zone of division. This is zone of division. So here at the center or towards the apex or towards the tip of the zone of division, here it has apical meristem. Imagine this is apical meristem. Then in the root, this apical meristem is covered or surrounded by a root cap. So this is root cap. Apical meristem is covered by a root cap. So then we will discuss step by step. So what's the function? What may be the function of this root cap? Here it provide mechanical protection. It provide protection to the apical meristem from friction. Here simply it's like this. When root grows into soil, due to friction, this apical meristem can be damaged. Then this root cap provide protection or provide mechanical protection to apical meristem from the friction when root grows into soil. That's the function. Okay, then here you know, this apical meristem consists of initials, those continuously divide by mitosis and add new cells, inwards as well as outwards. Initials in apical meristem divide by mitosis and add new cells inwards as well as outwards. And also here it's like this. Due to friction, when root grows into soil, due to friction, the outermost cells, these outermost cells of the root cap are removed off, continuously removed off from the root cap. Outermost cells of the root cap are continuously removed off due to friction. Those removed cells are replaced by the cells added from this apical meristem. That means cells removed from the apical meristem are replaced by the new cells added from the apical meristem. Apical meristem add new cells and push outwards. Those replace the cells of the root cap. Remember that. Okay, then we can discuss about root cap. Again, when we are discussing plant responses. Here some of the root cap cells have specialized plastids known as statoliths. We can discuss that when we are discussing plant responses. Anyhow, it's another function. Okay. Then here we said apical meristem add new cells inwards to the plant. Those new cells added inwards are pushed upwards into zone of elongation. That means upper to zone of division. Here it has zone of elongation. This region is, let's say this is zone of elongation. This is zone of elongation. As name implies, what should happen in zone of elongation? Cells are elongated. Cells are elongated due to accumulation of substances, mainly due to accumulation of water and other substances. So it says cells are elongated about 10 times in the zone of elongation. That involves in elongation of the root into soil. Okay, then those elongated cells are pushed upwards. Those elongated cells are pushed upwards into zone of maturation. So here, upper to zone of elongation, then at this region, it has zone of maturation. So here, let's say this is zone of maturation. Here you know that in zone of maturation, cells are differentiated. So differentiation happens in the zone of maturation. Upper to that, it has permanent tissues. Upper to zone of maturation, it has permanent tissues. Here it has permanent tissues. Okay, that means here we discuss a transverse section taken through these permanent tissues. Okay. Then here we will discuss how the cell differentiation happens in the zone of maturation to produce these permanent tissues. Okay. Then we said here elongated cells are pushed into zone of maturation. Then, in the zone of maturation, cells are differentiated and produce different permanent tissue cells. Silent tissue, phloem tissue, different other cells are produced. We can discuss how it happens. Okay. Here, at the beginning of zone of maturation, cells elongate, these elongated cells are differentiated and first produce three primitive tissues. At the beginning of zone of maturation, due to differentiation, three primitive tissues are produced. Those are known as protoderm. Three primitive tissues produced at the beginning of zone of maturation are protoderm, ground meristem, and procambium. Protoderm, ground meristem, and procambium. Okay, among these three primitive tissue layers, outermost tissue layer is the protoderm. Outermost tissue layer is the protoderm. Here, these are protoderm. Imagine these are protoderm. Outermost tissue layer, I can label protoderm like this. Imagine this is protoderm. It's outermost tissue layer. Protoderm differentiate. The cells of protoderm differentiate and produce the epidermis as the outermost tissue layer. So this is the epidermis with root hairs. Remember, epidermis with root hairs are produced from the protoderm. That's the outermost tissue layer. Another side also here we can say these are the root hairs produced in the epidermis which are produced from the protoderm. Here, the immature or young root hairs or differentiating root hairs can be observed in zone of maturation as well. Imagine these are the beginnings or the young root hairs found at the zone of maturation. Okay, that's about the protoderm and the epidermis. Then here we can observe in the permanent tissue, it has single vascular bundle. We said single cylindrical vascular bundle is found in the dicot root. Here, this vascular bundle is produced from the procambium. Procambium, cells of the procambium produce the vascular bundle. Remember that. That means this primary xylem, primary phloem, conjunctive tissue of vascular bundle, and in addition to that, outer pericycle are also produced from the procambium. Again, look at this. Which permanent tissue regions are produced from the procambium? Primary xylem, primary phloem, conjunctive tissue of the vascular bundle, and outer pericycle are produced from the procambium. Here, there is only single vascular bundle in the root. Therefore, there should be only single procambial strand. So, there is only single procambial strand. It's like this here. Imagine it's like this. It is the beginning of those procambial region. Imagine it's like this. Imagine now I am drawing the procambium. In a longitudinal section, I can draw single procambial strand like this. Imagine this is a procambium. This entire region is a procambium. This is procambium. Then here this should be the ground meristem there. So this is ground meristem. This part is ground meristem. Okay, then this ground meristem produces the cortex and endodermis. So actually the endodermis is also considered as the innermost layer of the cortex. Remember that endodermis also considered as the innermost layer of the cortex. These endodermis and cortex are produced from the ground meristem. Here, therefore, we can observe in the permanent tissue region. Here, this outer region is the cortex. Here, this part is the cortex. In addition to that, it has the endodermis. So, here, I will draw the innermost cells of the ground meristem. Produce the endodermis. Imagine now, this is the endodermis. Okay, let's say this is endodermis. Endodermis produced from the ground meristem. Okay, then we will discuss how this primary xylem, primary phloem, conjunctive tissue and pericycle are produced from the procambium. This single procambial strand gives rise to those tissues. Here, first, outermost cells or cells at the periphery of the procambium differentiate and produce a pericycle. Imagine here the outermost cells of the procambial strand differentiate and form the pericycle. So, in the permanent tissue region, here we can observe the pericycle. Imagine it is this. Here this is pericycle. Okay. Then primary xylem and primary phloem region should be produced. Should be differentiated. Now before discussing differentiation, again look at these permanent tissues. We said primary xylem has two regions as protoxylem and metaxylem. Among these, protoxylem originates first and it is found at the periphery.
Then later to protocylum. Metacylum is originated medial to protocylum. Protocylum is found at the periphery, which originate first. Then later, metacylum is originated medial to protocylum. That means, in other words, we can say primary xylem is differentiated from periphery to the medial direction. Periphery to the medial direction. Here, in the zone of differentiation or zone of maturation, primary xylem should be differentiated. Protocylum should be differentiated first at the periphery. Then towards the medial side, medial to the protocylum, metacylum should be differentiated. So, it's like this here. Imagine this is the differentiation of primary xylem or protocylum. Protocylum should be differentiated first. Then outermost cells of the procambium here first differentiate and produce the protocylum. Imagine this is a protocylum. The differentiation of primary xylem, and this is, imagine this is the protocylum. It differentiates first. This part is a protocylum. It continuously found upwards. Here, this part is a protocylum. So I will label here. Erase these two parts. Within here, let's say this is protocylum. Got that? It is found at the periphery. Then medial to protocylum, later medial to protocylum, later. That means here we can observe, this is the beginning, later medial to protocylum, metacylum is originated. Imagine this is the metacylum. This, let's say here this is the metacylum. Got that? So this is metacylum. Collectively, this primary xylem, protocylum and metacylum form the primary xylem. Let's say this is the primary xylem. This part is primary xylem. Then you can observe protocylum is found at the periphery. Metacylum is found medial to protocylum. Then in other words, you can say primary xylem is differentiated from periphery to the medial direction. Got that? That is how primary xylem is differentiated. Then here, you will confuse here. Why? Because we have drawn four corners in the primary xylem, but here I have drawn only single part. It's like this. That means in a longitudinal section, when we are showing the differentiation, we can't show all these four corners. So imagine this is a longitudinal section. That part, that is a longitudinal section taken through a region like this here. Okay, then imagine it's like this. That longitudinal section is found through a line like this. Then it has epidermis, cortex, endodermis, pericycle, then single part of primary xylem where protocylum is found at the periphery, metacylum is found in the middle. Then other side it has the primary phloem. But then again pericycle, endodermis, cortex, epidermis, like that. Okay, then here now we can discuss the differentiation of this primary phloem. It is found at the other side. Here, in phloem also, protophloem should be originated first, then later to that, medial to protophloem, metaphloem should be originated. So we can draw it like this. When differentiating, first at the periphery, protophloem here, protophloem is originated or differentiated. It is continuously found upwards like this. So this part is the protophloem. This is protophloem. Then inner to protophloem, later, metaphloem is originated. Let's say this is the metaphloem. Inner to that, here this is the metaphloem. Got that? So this is the protophloem, this is the metaphloem. Okay then, here collectively, protophloem and metaphloem collectively form the primary phloem. So this is primary phloem. This is primary xylem, this is primary phloem. Got that? Okay then, the middle cells of the procambium or the remaining cells of the procambium differentiate into parenchyma cells and remain in between primary xylem and primary phloem and give rise to conjunctive tissue. Here you can observe in between primary xylem and primary phloem, it has parenchyma cells differentiated from the procambial cells. That's the conjunctive tissue. So this is conjunctive tissue. This is conjunctive tissue. You can observe it. Got that? So this is how differentiation happens. Okay. This is the cortex, I will erase it earlier. But then here, now you can draw this longitudinal section on your note. Copy this to your note. And label all these parts. Here label this as protophloem and metaphloem. Okay, again you can pause the video and draw the diagram in the appropriate place.
Okay, that's about the primary growth structure of dicot plant root. Then we can discuss the growth structure of monocot plant root.
It's also like this, very similar, but there are only some differences. We will discuss growth structure of monocot plant root. I will erase this.
Okay, now we will discuss primary growth structure. Of monocot plant root. Monocot plant root, here we are considering a transverse section. Taken through permanent tissues. Remember, here we are considering a transverse section taken through permanent tissues. Monocot plant root also more similar to dicot plant root, but the arrangement of vascular bundle is different. So it's like this. Here, as we discussed in the previous case regarding the dicot root, outermost cellular layer should be epidermis. Imagine now I'm drawing the epidermis. Outermost cellular layer should be epidermis. Imagine now I'm drawing the epidermis. This is epidermis, it has root hairs. This epidermis with root hairs. It is structurally and functionally similar to dicot plant root. Okay, as in the dicot root, inner to epidermis, here we label. So this is epidermis. So this is a root hair. Structurally and functionally similar to dicot root. Inner to epidermis, it has a cortex. As in dicot root, here this also has a cortex. Okay, imagine this is cortex. It is made up of parenchyma, involving radial transport and storage. Similar. The inner to cortex, or as the innermost layer of the cortex, we said earlier, as the innermost layer of the cortex, it has endodermis. We said endodermis also considered as the innermost layer of the cortex. So this is endodermis. Again, it is similar. The inner to endodermis, it has pericycle. Here this is a pericycle. As in dicot root, this also may consist of two or three cell layers. So this is the pericycle. Structurally, this is similar to dicot root, but there's a functional difference. Can you remember we said in dicot root, the pericycle cells can involve in producing the cork cambium during the secondary growth. We said in dicot root, the parenchyma cells of pericycle later get the meristematic activity and involve in forming the cork cambium during secondary growth. But in monocot plants, there is no secondary growth. Monocot plants do not undergo secondary growth. Therefore, the pericycle cells of monocot root doesn't possess the meristematic activity. That means those cells do not get the meristematic activity and doesn't involve in forming the cork cambium. No secondary growth. That's a functional difference. Okay, the inner to pericycle, it has xylem and phloem regions. Here, in dicot root, there is only single vascular bundle with xylem with four arms. But here, there are many xylem regions and many primary phloem regions. So, it's like this. Imagine these are, this is the xylem region and this is a phloem region. Again, this is a phloem region and this is a xylem region. Likewise, large number of primary xylem regions and primary phloem regions are arranged alternatively. You can observe xylem region, phloem region. Again, xylem, phloem. Large number of primary xylem and primary phloem regions are arranged alternatively as a ring here. So imagine this is primary phloem and this is primary xylem. This is primary xylem. So, large number of primary xylem and primary phloem regions are arranged alternatively with as a ring. Then here, in the monocot root, there is a central core of parenchyma. Here at the center, there is a core of parenchyma. It's a pith. It's known as pith.
We can't observe a pith in dicot root, but in monocot root in the middle it has a comparatively large pith made up of parenchyma. That those parenchyma cells involved in storage. Okay. And here we said in a dicot root primary xylem has only four arms or four corners. Therefore, such a xylem is known as tetrarch xylem. But here you can observe there are many corners in this primary xylem. There are many xylem regions with many corners. Therefore, this type of xylem can be termed as polyarch xylem. It's a polyarch xylem. Polyarch xylem. Many xylem regions are, many corners of xylem regions are present. Here also, this primary xylem also consists of two regions based on the origin. Those are protoxylem and metaxylem. Phloem also like that. Phloem also consists of protophloem and metaphloem. Here if you consider xylem, primary xylem, protoxylem that originate first is located more towards the periphery. So this, let's say this is protoxylem, which is located more towards the periphery, as in dicots, dicot root. Metaxylem that originate later is found medial to protoxylem. So this is metaxylem. This is metaxylem. Again, protoxylem that originate first is located towards the periphery. Metaxylem originate later and found medial to protoxylem. So we gave a name in dicot root. What's that name? When protoxylem is located more towards the periphery, such a xylem is known as exarch xylem. So here you can observe this is also an exarch xylem. Protoxylem is located towards the periphery. Therefore, this is also an exarch xylem. Okay. So then those are the differences. Okay, then here now you can draw this. You can observe here clearly the differences are found only with this vascular bundle, and actually there is a pith. So draw this on your note. There is a space there. And focus on the differences. Differences can be asked. And label all these parts as well. So this is the root structure of monocot plant root.